Hi, my name's Bud Tingle, and I'm delighted to be able to introduce this series of audiobooks known as the Belinda Classics. Each of the titles featured in this series has played a significant role in Australian literature. Each of them, in their own way, has a role in exploring what it is to be Australian. From stories of adventure set in the outback to those of the struggle of the individual to realise themselves against hardship and limitations, these books give us insight into the human condition and what has shaped us as individuals in this great country. These are all audiobooks that can be listened to over and over again. Most importantly, we believe that these classic books will continue to entertain and inspire audiobook listeners for many years in the future.
Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of All the Rivers Run, Book One, A River Not Yet Tamed. Written by Nancy Cato and read by Kate Hosking. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. All the rivers run into the sea, yet the sea is not full. Unto the place from whence the rivers come, thither they return again. Ecclesiastes 1:7. Prologue. High in the Australian Alps, a little stream, just born, moves invisibly beneath the snow, or can be glimpsed through a blue-shadowed hole between the melting snow bridges. Grown wider and deeper, it swirls round boulders, foams through rapids and leaps over waterfalls, until at last it flows out upon the plains as a broad and noble river. By now it has been joined by tributaries from the south, from the east and from the north, draining an enormous watershed. Samples of every mineral and organic substance in the world, it is said, can be found in the waters of the Murray. Gold and clay, coal and limestone, dead men and dead fish, fallen trees and rotting boats, all are carried in solution or suspension in that placid stream. It is like life dissolved in time, always passing away, yet endlessly renewed, forever changing, yet eternally the same. Growing more complex the further it travels, the river has become old and sluggish by the time it nears the sea. Scarcely flowing, the current meanders through wide lakes and sandy channels towards the breakers of Goolwa Beach, the league-long rollers of the Southern Ocean. The little town of Goolwa grew up on the last bend of the great slow, weary river. The old buildings, made of the local limestone, have weathered to the same colour as the low, sunburnt hills behind. In front, the river stretches beyond the broken and deserted wharf. A few old paddle boats are tied up as houseboats, or rest on the mud at a crazy angle. You might visit the town of Goolwa a dozen times and not know the sea was near, nor the mouth of the Murray lost in its maze of sandhills. Then, on a day of south wind, or a still night of midsummer, you will become aware of a tenuous thunder, a faint booming roar just within the bounds of hearing. It is the voice of the sea. The river may be calm and glassy, reflecting the bright shape of the cross in its dark waters, but always that thunder of the surf underlies the quiet pervading the stillness with its deathless sound. Now all has become one, the trickle under the snow, the waterfall, the mountain torrent and the gliding stream. And the river, already within sound of its final dissolution, seems to say, "There is no death. In my end is my beginning." Book One, A River Not Yet Tamed. Stars sweep and question not. This is enough, that life and death and joy and woe abide, and cause and sequence and the course of time and being's ceaseless tide which, ever-changing, runs linked like a river. Edward Arnold, The Light of Asia. Chapter 1. thin white smoke was drifting upward, to be lost in an expanse of pale and exquisite blue. Incense, she thought. This must be heaven, this infinite blueness. Yet she still seemed to have a body. Something was hurting. The back of her nose and throat, and there was a memory of someone, was it herself? Coughing and retching. Her chest was sore. She turned her head and into her line of vision came a man, a giant of a man who towered up into the sky. He had a beard, but he didn't look much like God. His round, red, kindly face was half obscured by his whiskery growth, dark but sprinkled with grey. His chest was covered with hair too, above a pair of faded blue dungarees rolled up to the knee.
Feeling better, love?
The red face bent over her and smiled, showing stained and broken teeth. She tried to smile back.
Yes, thank you.
As she heard her own voice, the memory of what had happened swept over her like an icy wave, like the wave that had swept her into the sea. She had got up very early before dawn, because it was their last night on board. Tomorrow they would reach Melbourne and land in Australia for the first time. She longed to see the country her father had talked so much about, where her mother's sister had come to live years ago. Yesterday she had seen its coastline to the northwest, low, blue and mysterious. She had smelt the faint, warm, spicy breath of the land breeze at evening. Her father had said it was the trees, the eucalyptus scrub, that scented the wind. She had woken early this morning and dressed quietly, to go up on deck alone and feel for the last time the ship lifting beneath her feet over the long southern rollers, like a great gallant horse that cantered over the plains of the sea. It was so dark that she could see only the white water hissing along the side, and a few stars that were being swiftly blotted out by a bank of cloud moving silently, inexorably across the sky. Full sails arced above her, wind shrilled in the rigging. By the ghostly glow of the binnacle lamp, she could see the helmsman, and behind him the officer of the watch. No one else was on deck, but the lookout man away in the bows. The dark surface of the sea flashed in lines of white as the swelling wave crests rose. Suddenly, there came a frantic cry from the lookout.
Breakers! Breakers ahead!
Even as the officer roared an order and the helmsman wrenched the wheel hard over, the ship struck with a splintering crash. The masts bent like trees in a gale. The stays parted with a bang. A great foam-crested wave reared up astern and fell upon the stricken ship. And she, Delly Gordon, the only passenger on deck, had been buried deep in icy water and swept overboard. Chapter 2. With a jolt and a hiss of escaping steam, the little train pulled up at the dark station. It was a very slow train. It had bumped and swayed along for half the day and part of the night to reach its destination. It stood now, panting with contented achievement. The line went no further. The guard flung open the door. Exactly as if the one small passenger who remained had been a compartment full of people, he shouted,
"Kuma! Kuma, change here for the mountain coach!"
She began gathering her scattered things, her gloves, the bulging carpet bag full of spare stockings, hankies, petticoats and a change of shoes, the box of fruit and the ladies' home journal, and put on the new straw hat with black ribbons which the kindly solicitor, a perfect stranger, had insisted on buying for her in Melbourne.
"That's all right, my dear. You can pay me back from your father's estate when your affairs are all fixed up, if you want to."
And he added a pair of gloves and some shoes. Everyone had been so kind, so wonderfully kind. Here she was with a bag full of things thrust upon her by Mrs. Brownlow, the lady in whose care she had travelled all the way to Goulburn, where she changed trains. Even one of her dresses, much too large, and a travelling cloak. Mrs. Brownlow's sympathy had been well meant but rather overpowering. She had been glad to find herself alone at last. Now she was beginning to feel nervous. All was dark and strange. She hoped her uncle would be waiting at the station. The guard, looking at the small white face of his last passenger, dropped the official manner and became fatherly.
"Give us your ticket, love," he said, "and hand over that there bag. Got everything?
Looked under the seat. Righto.
She followed him out into an icy wind. The small station was dimly lit by two square lamps. A tall man with a drooping moustache and a dark beard stepped towards her. He wore an overcoat reaching almost to his heels and a wide-brimmed felt hat.
"Is this Miss Philadelphia Gordon?"
he asked.
"You her uncle?"
said the guard.
"I was told to hand her over to a Mr. Charles Jamieson of Keandra."
"That's right. Here you are, and thanks." The guard received something unobtrusively in his palm. "How are you, child?" The tall man bent and kissed her cheek. The whiskers tickled. She smiled up at him shyly. He was only her uncle by marriage, but he was the first relative she had met, almost her only relative, in this strange new land. He looked down at her in mild surprise.
"So, you are Philadelphia. I'd expected a little girl."
And he indicated a height not much above his knee.
"Oh, but I'm nearly 13, Uncle, and I'm tall for my age. Mother says..."
She faltered while the tears which excitement had kept back began prickling behind her eyes.
Mother used to say I shot up too fast."
He put the bag down, drew her hand through his arm and patted it with his other hand.
"I hope that Auntie Hester will be a new mother to you, my dear. We're looking forward very much to having you. We'll have to fatten you up a bit, though. Your aunt is a very good cook."
She was glad he had not said anything about the wreck, a subject about which she would not yet speak without breaking down. As they walked to the hotel, she told him about the trip from the south coast by wagon team to Melbourne, and her friend the seaman who had rescued her, the only passenger to survive. But she did not mention the dreadful days they had spent on the beach, nor the dark shapes bobbing sluggishly in the waves that she still saw in dreams. As they came out of the shelter of the station, the wind swooped on them. The air was cold and dry and thin. It pierced straight through the borrowed cloak. The name of the hotel was the Australian Arms, she noted with a little thrill of strangeness.
"We'd better get some sleep because the Adaminaby coach leaves at 6 tomorrow morning," said her uncle.
She was called while it was still dark and stumbled into her clothes by the light of the candle. Breakfast consisted of tea, too hot for her to drink, and burnt toast with great lumps of salty, unmelted butter. She was still half asleep when they went out to the lighted coach. Stars still showed in patches in the cloudy sky. Huge shapes seemed to rise up all round the horizon. There was a feeling of height in the very atmosphere, and the windless air was piercingly cold. The coach started with a sudden forward rush. Wakened by the cold fresh air, she suddenly felt excitement well up in her throat like a bubble. How she loved to be setting off for somewhere, anywhere, in the mysterious light of dawn.
"Tell me about your gold mine, Uncle Charles," she said, feeling the necessity to be companionable.
"Well..."
He looked suspiciously at the three other passengers. Rugged features, wild, whiskered men wrapped in layers of shapeless clothing. Then he said loudly,
"You couldn't call it a mine. I'm just fossicking in the old Keandra lead. All the good stuff was taken out years ago. Get a bit of colour now and then, not worth the time I put into it."
Then he turned and gave her a long, slow wink. She didn't quite know what to make of this, so she said,
"What about the mountains? Are there big, huge snow peaks all around, like in Switzerland?"
"Why? Have you been to Switzerland?"
"No, but my father sent me a postcard of the Jungfrau after he'd been to the top. It is 13,677 feet high. My father used to take us climbing in the north of England. He promised to take us..."
She faltered and tears sprang to her eyes. There was no us anymore. Just herself, alone. He patted her hand.
"I'll take you up a mountain one day, but they're a good way from Keandra. That's just hills, though it's 5,000 feet up. But you'll see Mount Kosciuszko this morning."
She squeezed his hand, inarticulately grateful that he had not tried to offer her any spoken sympathy for her loss. He looked down at her carefully.
"I didn't get a chance to see you properly last night. Blue eyes, eh? And black hair. Just the sort of little girl I always wanted."
"It isn't really black. It's very dark brown."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.